Welcome to Everything Rodeo, where we separate champions from the rest of the crowd.
We'll take you down the trail of someone's life, a long haul to a rodeo, and our everyday adventures.
So brace yourself,
because it's fixing to be a wild ride.
We're your hosts,
Mace Renfrey
and Cody Stanley. Welcome to the Everything Rodeo podcast, and today we're not in the crawl space, we're in the front porch of the Carlink Ranch.
Southern Arizona, beautiful weather at the moment.
Very nice.
Yeah, here at the Carlink Ranch with Andy and Steph Smallhouse. Thank you guys for having us out to your ranch. Let me get the applause. Yeah.
Thank you guys. Thank you. All the crowd around us.
So my uncle Brad met Andy at a conservation camp in... what year was it? Do you even remember?
It was probably like 1988.
Okay.
89.
Okay. So it's been a while. And you guys, were you guys best friends growing up then?
We were real close. Yeah. So, yeah. But we lived a ways apart. Of course, he lived in Phoenix and right. I lived down here in Southern Arizona. But yeah, we hung out when we could and we got to be really good friends and we stayed good friends. We're still real good friends.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. And so with, later on, we'll talk a little bit about the involvement with the Arizona Game and Fish and conservation. You guys went to a conservation camp at a young age, became good friends, and then now the ranch has evolved, and you've been working with Arizona Game and Fish and just different ways to benefit the wildlife and the ecosystem and everything within your ranch. So tell us a little bit about Carlink Ranch, when it was established and everything.
Well, we were established in 1884. Actually, our family came to Arizona in 1879, to Southern Arizona, and there was a lot of pressure from the Native Americans, and they moved down a little bit further north where we established here in 1884, and they got into it to contract to sell beef to the military, and they didn't have a whole lot of experience. William Bayless was the first generation, and I'm fifth generation on the ranch, and he was an entrepreneur basically, and thought, you know, there's money to be made in the beef industry, and they were trying to settle the West, so they were encouraging people to come. He came from Kansas to Arizona to settle the West, and there was a lot of open space for grazing. Mm-hmm. And so that's how we got established, and we're a little smaller now, but we've been at it ever since.
So do you think that back in the day, as a rancher now, if you were in Kansas, would you want to try to bring your ranch to the West out here in this desert?
Well, actually, I mean, there's a misconception. People come out here and they think, you know, why would you graze cattle? That's the first question on everyone's mind is, yeah, why would you graze cattle in this desert and cactus and everything else? But we actually have a lot larger diversity of plants than Kansas or the Midwest, back East. And, you know, you see all that grassland and flatland, but we, with our weather and, you know, if we do get moisture, if we get, like we've had really good rain the last years or so, we grow a lot of feed year round. We're growing feed right now in the winter, and a lot of places aren't. And yeah, and we have it's just like a human's diet, you know. So cattle, they need a diverse diet also. And so when times are good with the climate, we have less disease and so forth because we have less. It's a drier climate. So that's why a lot of the feedlots and dairies are moving to the West because of the climate. And so we have a. It's actually ideal for raising cattle, and it's a lot of land that wouldn't be, you know, used for other things, and we're able to use it, and we bring money into the state and the federal government by paying to use that land, and we're actually, you know, a free caretaker of the land for the state, whether it's state government or federal government. We're out there checking waters, and it also benefits the wildlife. As you mentioned, you know, with Brad, you know, who would have known he'd go into, you know, well, he was interested in natural resources, and now he was the president of the Bighorn Sheep Society a while back, and so he's working with the Game and Fish, and we're doing projects because I really think that, you know, for a while there, it was the environmental groups against the ranchers.
Yeah, for sure.
And even though politics is really divided right now, I think that as far as it goes with working with these environmental groups, actually it's gotten better. Mm-hmm. And I think the pendulum's swinging where the all these agencies are wanting to pool money together. They're finding out, hey, maybe these ranchers aren't so bad. Maybe it's better than having houses or whatever. If they're not there, it's going to be developed.
Right.
And so they're more willing to work together, and it's actually going in the right direction. And as far as that goes, I think, thanks to people like Stephanie going and educating them in Washington and all over the state, and groups like Farm Bureau that really have outreach, whether it's in schools or whatever. But I've seen a big change in just my short time here of, you know, groups. You know, you have radical ranchers and you have radical environmentalists, and they're sort of getting pushed out. Mm-hmm. And if you don't come to the middle these days, you're not going to make it. And you have to. I mean, there's not a lot of money in ranching, and you have to work together.
Right.
So when you say there's like different, more varieties for the cows to eat and stuff here, so like where we're from, it's pretty much just grass and like just native grasses. Here, like they eating a cactus or what's yeah, the other got, stuff I that mean, they got?
In tough times, they'll eat cactus, and they eat a little bit of cactus. They've got a lot of shrubs and forbs, and where you have in the, you know, Midwest or back east, there's probably, you know, maybe on ranches, there's three or four different grass types. Mm-hmm. Over here, there's 30 different grass types. Yeah. And some of them are growing different temperatures. Like right now, we have a fillery, which is very high protein. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of, I would guess they'd be considered forbs that have a lot of high protein. And they it helps their diet. And everything, you know, health is about, my dad taught me that at an early age. You know, you want healthy cattle, you give them a good diet. It's just like humans, right? You take care of if you give them a good diet and what they need, and you study nutrition. Of course, we supplement too with vitamins and protein when they need it, and nutrients. And that helps the cattle a lot. And they, you know, we're able to get as much money. People say, oh, the cattle in the West aren't as good, you know. And we're able to get as much money for our cattle. We've topped the market for the whole country before. Not always, but, you know, with our cattle and the programs we do. And they actually like them because they come in healthy. There, a lot of them are, the most of feedlots where they're finishing them out are still in Kansas, Colorado, Texas. Mm-hmm. So they're leaving here. We don't have a whole lot of feedlots in Arizona that are finishing them out. We do have dairies, and we don't. And the slaughterhouses, we're not real close to the slaughterhouses, but
yeah.
So how many head of cattle can you run on a acre, or how many acres does it take to run a head of cows here?
So it takes a lot more acres. That's the challenge in it is you know, you have to have, and we found, you know, in the old days we had big roundups, you know, but the cattle were a lot wilder because you're talking 60 to 80 acres at least.
Per
cow and calf on in this land. Mm-hmm. And so, but we've gotten our cattle where they're real. We try to make a good experience when we move them. You know, we move them to better ground. We try not to rough them up too much. And we brand them at a really young age so it's easier on them. And we ride basically year-round and brand year-round. And we've changed that from having roundups once or twice a year. So the cattle are seeing people horseback. All the time. And, you know, my dad actually started a policy. He's the one that started going in that direction. And he had a policy that, you know, if he saw a calf that was over 3 months old and wasn't branded, then the guys were in trouble. Maybe even fired, you know, because it was a big deal. And he realized that, you know, so it's an incentive. Like I have four cowboys all the time, and I let them make their schedule sort of. And they know they're like, today's one day off that they're not riding. Every other day this week they rode, and today they're shoeing horses, you know, because they got to maintain their, you know, keep shoes on the horses. And so every other day, starting Monday, they'll be back on horseback, and they'll be gathering, they'll be weaning, branding, and bringing in if they see any cows that are dry or that are sick. And so they're out every day.
So how many awesome. How many acres now do you own here at the ranch?
Well, it's definite. How do you answer? I don't usually say.
Well, because you run cows on government land as well, right?
Yeah.
So you.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's
quite a bit.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just a weird question. I know it's not everyone asks that. It's just that you know, the way I was raised, my dad always taught me never say how many acres you have or whatever. It's sort of like saying how much money you got in the bank, even though it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it's not the same.
But, it's too bad it's not.
It's not the same. We have three ranches, and we've got about 1,400 cow-calf pairs right now all together.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So, that's cool.
Yeah, so earlier you talked about your wife and everything that she does. So we know your family's a big advocate for farmers and ranchers with water rights. So, Steph, do you want to kind of touch on what you do? And I guess
it's probably better for me to talk about her because she doesn't like bragging about herself. So maybe I should
very
talk
humble,
to this.
Very, yeah.
Yeah, I'll let her talk.
Well, I will brag on the organization that I represent, though, because I'm very proud of it, and I'm very proud of the people that I work with. But it's really just a team effort. So I'm serving in my sixth year as president of Arizona Farm Bureau. Awesome. That's an elected position. A lot of agricultural industry groups have kind of paid leadership. But in Farm Bureau, we have elected volunteers, and then we have staff that work with us that really do all of the work.
Yeah.
And so we have 15 counties in Arizona. They're huge counties, unlike probably where you all are from. You probably have a lot of tiny counties, but many counties. So we have 15 counties in Arizona, and every county is represented through a Farm Bureau. We have two counties that share one Farm Bureau. But we're very proud of the fact that we're grassroots, and so all of our members belong to a federation. So if you're a member of Farm Bureau, so like in Arkansas Farm Bureau, you're a member of the County Farm Bureau, and that automatically makes you a member of the State Farm Bureau and American Farm Bureau. And so what that means is that if you are a member, you basically have people fighting for you in the agriculture industry at your county level, your county board that's elected, at your state level, your state board that's elected, and at the national level of a grouping of presidents from all over the country. And so so basically we used to be very policy focused in Farm Bureau. Mm-hmm. We used to be very much about going to the state legislature and the national capital and talking about issues like water and regulation. But now we spend just as much time talking about education, getting in the schools, talking about kids, where their food comes from.
Yeah.
And we also spend a lot of time just communicating with the public. So, you know, we have full-time folks that's all they do is they get out there in the social media, different platforms, you know, old-fashioned type stuff like radio and television.
It's all out.
Yeah, and we have our regular newspapers and things like that. So it's kind of a three-legged stool. It's communicating about agriculture. It's getting into the schools, educating kids about where their food comes from, and then our traditional being at the capitals and different legislatures. So
when you talk about going into schools and stuff and showing kids how or where their food comes from, how much through the years have you seen that kids don't realize that their meat and their milk and stuff don't just come from Walmart or from the local grocery store?
Well, you know, sadly, I wouldn't lay it all at the feet of kids. I mean, adults don't even know. So, you know, I think, you know, I recently told somebody if we had started doing 20 years ago what we started doing 5 years ago, we would have had a whole generation now that would be more informed about the fact that their eggs don't come out of the cold case at the refrigerator.
Yes.
And their beef doesn't get made, you know, essentially from scratch at McDonald's. So I wish we had started, but, you know, that's the way everything is. But we're going very strong now. And we are seeing some impact. You know, the education part of it is a very slow moving process, and it's a goal that's going to take a long time. And so we're just going to have to remain vigilant for a very long time. I think during COVID and the pandemic, it sort of snapped everybody out of this like haze that they were in, that all of their food, you know, just comes from the grocery store. And they heard a lot in the news about what was happening at the dairy and what was happening. And the interesting thing about that is that like during the pandemic when you went to the grocery store and you couldn't find certain things, mm-hmm. there's plenty of food in the country.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's plenty of food being produced. And farmers and ranchers, you know, never, we kept working. We kept going when everybody else
was essential.
Kind of, yeah, when everybody else was shut down. But the problem was the supply chain and mm-hmm. how logistics work. You know, so that's something that we're looking at a lot now in terms of local resilience with food supply is, you know, people should be asking themselves, okay, where I live, do I see any farms and ranches?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And how far away are those farms and ranches? And, you know, are those, you know, are those local industries, are they doing well? What can we do to help them be resilient so yes. that the next time we have a situation like this, I know that, you know, I'm still going to be able to get milk mm-hmm. and beef and eggs and, you know, specialty crops like, you know, your fruits and vegetables, because I live near where food grows, you mm-hmm. know? And so that's a big part of it. But we also, you know, have to recognize that not everywhere can grow, you know, food, not everywhere right. you can see a farm and ranch. And so what, how do we as the public make ourselves aware of that food chain system and what it needs to be sustainable in the long run?
Yeah. Yeah. So out here at Carlink Ranch, you're about, I would say 30 minutes to the closest town. So how back in the day did you, I know the San Pedro River doesn't really hold water, but how getting water rights out here and constantly fighting for water, what's kind of the history on that? And how do you, because I'm sure there's still, you have to kind of put up a fight to have water out here in this rural area.
Yeah, we have, and I'll just speak to the, like the legal policy side of it, but Andy yeah. can speak to the historical okay. part of the ranch having water. But we have in our particular area, plenty of water. We're in a very good watershed. We have a very high water table. Even if you don't see water running on the surface,
right.
it's running just beneath the surface. So we have a lot of challenges here in the fact that I think, Andy, you're the third generation now to basically be in court
okay.
over the same water. Wow. And it's not a matter of not having enough water. It's a matter of who has the right to use it. And so Arizona is a first in time, first in right, and you have to put water to the highest and best use. And so there are a lot of people fighting for water, and particularly in Arizona, there are other parts of the state, has been in the news lately with the Colorado River, where there isn't enough water.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so in our particular case, you know, we are in a lot of court situations where we're talking about, okay, how long have you been using the water? Are you putting it to its highest and best use? Where does that water really come from? Is it coming from groundwater or is it surface water? And right. so lots of complicated issues that would take much more than your podcast to talk about, but I guess I would just summarize it in saying that agriculture, you know, there's three main uses for water, really, mm-hmm. in terms of surviving, right? It's drinking, sanitation, and growing food. Mm-hmm. And lots of people in the West right now are facing drought conditions and facing not enough water. And so we're reaching ahead where it's like, okay, where does the law... Where is the line between the law and the water right and sustainability of food production?
Yeah.
And so we have a very strong water right here, but that doesn't mean that we're not going to continue fighting for the right to use that water for right. a very long time. And we feel like what we're using it for is the highest and best use.
Absolutely.
But that doesn't certainly make us feel like we don't need to just keep, you know, working on that issue very diligently.
Right.
But I don't know. Did you want to say something about that?
Well, I can just give you the historical aspect of okay. what has changed on the ranch mm-hmm. as far as, you know, where, you know, the water. And actually when they came in here, or when our family came in here, there was the San Pedro was running almost year round. And they diverted water, so it was actually surface water that they started using
wow.
For farming. Mm-hmm. And before we came in, there was Spanish settlers that came in, and of course, before that was the Native Americans. And there was farming along here for years, and then for whatever reason, you know, the mesquite came in and encroached, and it's an invasive species. And it sort of took over the valley. And so there's actually been a fight, you know, about that, whether, you know, some groups want more bird habitat and don't want the farms. And it's sort of frustrating for me to see farmers losing their ability to farm mm-hmm. because the net result of that is that if you quit managing these lands for farmland,
then you lose them.
Then you lose them into mesquite, these mesquite thickets, which is actually using three times the amount of water that the farmland was. And so it's really frustrating for me from that standpoint. It's like we're fighting, spending thousands of dollars on lawyers to keep our water rights when it's a net gain. If we're not here, we're gonna lose water. You know, there's gonna be less water in the river because a lot of these farmers have gone out of business and the river's dried up because the mesquite's taken over. I mean, it's just a mesquite thicket.
So when did the mesquite come in?
It came in the early 1900s. Probably 1930, 40, you know, the mesquite started coming in. I would say the early 1900s is when it came in, and it may have been brought in from either birds or they're bringing cattle in from Mexico. Right. There was some mesquite up on the uplands, you know, before, but our ranch was called the Sacatone Ranch. It was all Sacatone bottom. And the Sacatone sort of died off, and that, you know, there was no more fire, and that the Sacatone, the mesquite started, you know, taking over, and there was no management. Like, whoever had the most cattle had controlled the land.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what they did, because they were encouraging people to come to the West. And in order to control the land, it was who had the most cattle. Basically, you discouraged other homesteaders from homesteading here, and the ones that were here, you encouraged them to leave by having the most cattle. So until the Taylor Grazing Act, which was passed in, I think, like 1934, the Taylor Grazing Act was passed, and my great uncle, I've got memoirs that he helped push. He wrote letters to D.C. He was, you know, educated and saw that the land was being overgrazed because they were concentrated along the river,
mm-hmm.
and that was their only water source, were either down low or up really high where there was springs. They didn't have pipelines and all the dams and stuff that we've now put in and to distribute the cattle better. And so that the river was overgrazed, and then the mesquite came in and took over. Well, then, from that point, we realized, okay, we need to get rid of some of this mesquite. So my dad spent most of his life clearing out the mesquite. And actually, when he did that, the river came up in a lot of places and started actually running again.
Wow.
And
just so that's, removing that, some of the mesquite.
From removing the mesquite. And like on our, we had a diversion canal growing up, and I could, you know, it was just... we knew, like, we would run out of water when the mesquite got their leaves. And when they would freeze and lose their leaves, then the ditch would start running
back up,
and we could farm.
Yeah.
So we based our farming around that. Wow. You know, it's so obvious that how much water they use. Our wells would drop. Everything would drop when the mesquite leafed out. And so that's one of the frustrating things that I've seen over the years. You know, we're fighting to keep, you know, our water, and there's really no management, you know, of this mesquite and it's been pushed by a lot of environmental groups to have more mesquite along here for migratory birds, but it's not native.
It wasn't here before,
and it's an invasive species. Mm-hmm. So now, how are you going to turn that back? Because all these farms have gone out of business. We're the last original farm along this whole river that is in the same family left.
Wow.
And that I know of for quite a few miles anyway.
Wow. All right. So some from the invasive
invasion.
From the invasive mesquite trees coming in, you found a way to harvest that and start selling it to help benefit the ranch.
Yeah. One of the businesses I started several businesses, and you know, I always try to, in our business, you've got to make a negative into a positive.
Right.
on a daily basis. so I started my dad started selling some mesquite lumber, and we were always selling mesquite firewood and stuff. So But I made the big business bigger, and we it helped us get through a drought when we had to cut our numbers. We sold a lot of mesquite to high-end furniture places, and we're still selling mesquite lumber. And so that helps thinning these mesquite forests that we have, and it brings in some income in order to do brush control, you know. And we also sell firewood, as I said. And so we've tried to make as much positive as we can, you know, with the mesquite. And so that's one of our businesses.
What other businesses do you have that helps you keep the ranch going?
Probably one of my biggest business. I started about 10 businesses when we went into a drought, one of probably the worst droughts we've ever been in, and from about 97 to 98, 2013, it was about a 15-year drought where we had really low rainfall, and we had to cut our cow numbers back. And I started saguaro business, growing saguaro cactus from seed, because saguaros in Arizona, everyone, their low water use, everyone seemed their iconic type thing. When you move to Arizona, everyone wants a saguaro in their yard.
Yeah.
And that was actually, it's really slow growing them from seed. We collected seed and started them from seed, and you know, we're trying to figure out, there's not a whole lot known about them, but we're trying to grow them, you know, faster than naturally they grow, and we've but it's still about a 15-year turnaround for the size that the landscapers usually want, 4 to 6 foot saguaros. But there's a huge demand for them, and it's really helped bring in extra income for the ranch. And so that's, we have about 150,000 saguaros that we're growing right now. And we've done about 10,000 a year from seed, and we do each year to replenish them. So it's a good business, because it's low water use, and you know, people want them. There's a lot of demand for them.
Right.
And we're also my goal has always been to market beef direct, because we don't get the, even though meat's higher in the store, we haven't, the beef industry, you know, you've had all these increases since COVID with fuel and electric, and everything's doubled and tripled. Mm-hmm. Whereas meat hasn't, up until just a few months ago, meat was the same price it was before COVID, mm-hmm. you know, per pound as a live animal. And so, you know, you have, but in the stores it's higher. So there's someone's making money, and so we've been trying to market direct, but it's not easy to market direct, because you have to have your own slaughterhouse, you have to have your own feedlot.
Yeah.
And it's a big challenge. We've been working on it. I mean, since I graduated from college 30 years ago, I've been working on this project, and we're finally getting a slaughterhouse built in Tucson, where we can, and we have our own label. We trademarked the name Arizona Natural Beef, and we think, we think it'll help, it'll create more sustainability for, you know, future generations. My main goal is to pass this ranch on to my kids, and in order to, it's really, unfortunately, ranching at the price that we're getting, selling live animals, isn't sustainable in our situation, or most ranchers' situation with what we're getting for beef right now. So hopefully that'll make it more sustainable. I do, I also, you know, background other people's cattle is one business I've done in the past, you know, bringing them in and growing their heifers. We're one of the few ranches that also has farmland and mm-hmm. farms, and one of the few farms in Arizona that just, or anywhere probably, that farms just for cattle. Mm-hmm. So we have a unique situation where we can bring in cattle and put them on the farmland and get them the right nutrients, and which is vital for their first year of growth.
Yes, sir.
And so people realize that and bring their heifers that they're going to keep as cows, or their bulls that they want to keep raise up for bull and get them the right nutrition and not have them in a feedlot where they're confined and, mm-hmm. and not exercising right. at all. We have, you know, some range pasture that's incorporated within the farmland so we can move them around and they get more exercise and they're getting the right better nutrients when we're in drought especially. And then I bring in the heifers sometimes if they want, and I'll breed them artificially, inseminate them for them. So when they take them, then we'll test them to see if they're pregnant.
Right.
And when the rancher takes them back, they're ready to have a calf, and they can get the genetics they want. And it's worth money to do that for a lot of ranchers.
Yes, sir, for sure.
That's most of the ranches back home, I would say, is, you know, they out here it'd be different, but they grow, you know, and they'll cut silage yeah. to feed, and they'll have them in a lot or something like that for the yeah. most part, at least, you know, the dairies and stuff. But mm-hmm. out here, I don't see a lot of people, a different situation.
Yeah.
Right.
For sure.
Yeah. Right.
So you talked about wanting to pass down the ranch to your kids. At what age did you realize that you wanted to take the ranch over and be a part of it?
Oh, I don't know, probably when my dad kicked me off the ranch and said, wake up, son, when I was 18, screwing around, you know, out partying too much. And he said, you better wake up. And that's when I sort of realized, hey, you know, this isn't just going to be handed to me on a silver platter. Right. It's a lot of work, and it's a lot of, you have to learn a lot and be willing to be, you know, work through hard times and you know, I think, you know, I try to always make, you know, negatives into positives, good out of bad.
Yes, sir.
And unfortunately, after I graduated, 3 years after I graduated, my dad passed away of leukemia. So that sort of lit a fire under me, I think, and made me
kind of out of necessity.
Yeah, you had to either hit the ground running or lose the place. I mean, we were in a bad drought. Mm-hmm. And I always say that, you know, starvation sometimes creates innovation.
I like that. That's awesome. So, and where'd you go to college?
So I went to New Mexico State, and that's where I met my lucky to meet my lovely.
She's lucky to have you.
Yeah. I'm lucky to meet my lovely bride, Stephanie, at New Mexico State. I was majoring in range and animal science, and she was majoring in wildlife biology and range. And we met there, and then I sent her off to work for the government for a while to get trained over there, and then
So would you say that
with brought her back to the ranch? She didn't think that was a plan, but I had no
idea. Yeah, that's what I was just about to say. So when you was looking for your future wife, you looked at what she was studying, so you knew that it was going to be essential to the ranch, right?
Strategic.
Yeah, yeah. People probably think that for sure, but
we should have found somebody else then. Yeah. Totally.
Well, it seems like you've done a lot of good too for the ranch and just other ranchers. But
you know, what's funny is you bring that up. A lot of people, they say, "Oh, you're married to a wildlife biologist," you know, and they seem surprised. You know, to the general public, how we were talking about how they're not educated on what we do and everything. But I mean, honestly, if you think about it, it's a perfect match because ranchers, there's no one more reliant on the natural resources. I always tell everyone that than a rancher, because if we abuse the land and we don't have grass for our cattle, we're not gonna make it
without a paddle.
Yeah, we're not gonna make it. You know, yeah. and it has. I mean, we want a good ecosystem too. You have to love animals to do what I do. So the fact we love the wildlife. I mean, we're helping the wildlife while we're out there. Whether we're putting vitamin mineral supplement out or whether we're keeping waters going. I mean, there's waters every 2 miles of this ranch. You know, during the droughts, the farmland that we farm. I saw bears and mountain lion. I mean, deer, javelina, rabbits, every type of wildlife. Where do they come during the drought? That's another reason. You know, if they do away with these farms, your wildlife population is going to go down.
Right.
I mean, and not only that, if in these droughts, which is common in Arizona, you know, yeah. there we pump water up to all these waters 2 miles apart everywhere, which creates a better habitat, which, you know, Brad Renfrey has been helping me with the Bighorn Sheep Society and the State Game of Fish and actually the Federal Fish and Wildlife and so forth have been pooling money because they realize, hey, it helps the wildlife population the more
you're
they're
not,
spread
you're not
out.
Just helping the cattle and the rancher, right. You're helping the wildlife too.
Yeah.
So with all the wildlife, you have a lot of predators on the ranch. I mean, just last night we were sleeping in the rent house and just like you can hear coyotes for miles, you know. Yeah. And so, you know, we did some predator hunting yesterday and saw a couple coyotes, but does that play a big toll on your cattle or anything? Pigs and coyotes and predators?
Well, you know, it's like anything. You have to thin out. I mean, people are surprised sometimes when I, like Brad, for example, I get after him. Don't shoot all my coyotes because they kill my gophers, you know. We want a certain amount of predators because we don't have labor to go trap gophers all the time. So you have to balance. We're sort of try to be part of the balance, you know, and you know, if it's part of doing business to lose a few calves here and there. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I look at it. I'm not a huge hunter myself actually, but I mean, I have nothing against hunting. I just, it's part, you just have, everything has to work with a balance, you know, and
yes,
so,
sir.
So we sort of monitor that. And if the coyote population gets out of control, then we do have to do
take care of
predation
it.
Hunts and same with the mountain lion but we, you know, we don't want to get rid of all of them.
Right.
No, you got to keep the ecosystem balanced.
Yeah.
So there's an old story that I was told from my dad about your dad shooting a tail off a coyote. You know that story?
Probably. Yeah, it sounds familiar. Yeah. Yeah. I'm surprised. I don't know if I ever saw my, I may not have seen it. Well, he probably ended up killing it because I never hardly saw him ever miss a coyote. Like he,
really?
My dad was actually, his hobby was silhouettes, and he was actually at one time second in the nation in freestyle handgun silhouettes.
Yeah.
And so he was, unfortunately, I didn't get that trait. I don't practice enough. Brad will tell you that.
Well, Johnny told us you had a rule. The only rule was that you couldn't miss a coyote.
Yeah.
So
that started with my dad. He said, you know, if you only get one shot, if they get wild, then you're not going to be able to get them again.
Yeah, very true.
So don't shoot unless he'd get mad. He'd literally get mad if I missed, you know, and didn't, you know, if I was going to shoot one, you know, make sure you're going
to. Yeah, it's hard to kill them after they know they've been hunted and pressure's on them. So this kind of going back to college, but my Uncle Brad, he told me to ask you this question. How did you pay for college?
Oh, yeah, so when I paid my way through college, which my wife also did too, but she actually got good grades in high school and got some scholarships, whereas I screwed off a little bit and... In high school, and didn't get great grades. So I had, but I paid my way through college, and I planned ahead a little bit. I guess I planned I wasn't going to get good grades.
Yeah.
And so I grew pine trees and pumpkins in high school, and sold those
out here at the ranch.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I had a pine tree business. I also worked at a golf course and worked there. I always had a job all the way through high school, so I saved my money. But I grew like I said, pumpkins and pine trees, and I sold them as live pine trees for Christmas and landscaping and so forth. And that's most of what got me through college.
Yeah, and you were on the high school golf team.
Yeah,
that's what my Uncle Brad, he said. Yeah. I don't know how he got so good at golf. I'd imagine it's from working at the golf course.
Yeah.
You got to play a few rounds for free.
I couldn't do any after school sports because we didn't have a late bus. So,
oh yeah.
But then when I got a job at the golf course, like while I was waiting for waters to water out and change them, I would hit balls and stuff. And then I got to know the pro there at the golf course, and he gave me some lessons, and I joined the golf team, and that's how I learned how to golf. Yeah.
Is there anything else that you feel like you need to? Maybe the role of like the, not necessarily the role of the government, but just how they've kind of tried to maintain ranching over the years.
I don't know if I could say the government has tried to maintain ranches.
The lack of maintenance.
The lack of maintenance. Yeah. I would say that it's a constant push and pull. Basically, you have to find the people that want to work with you. And you have to find the people, you know, whether it's local, state, national government, whether it's just natural resource agencies or it's regulatory agencies, because there's all types of, I mean, we interact, when you're in agriculture, I bet you interact with more government agencies than anybody else.
Yeah.
I mean, you interact with everybody from the EPA to the FDA to the USDA. I mean, it's just.
They all got a finger in ranching.
They do, you know, if you're down on the border, you're working with the Border Patrol. I mean, it's just unreal how many different agencies. And then at the local level, you're working with the Department of Water Resources, with the Game and Fish Department. And I think the difference between your experience is, one, being open to work with your regulators and the people who work with the same resources that you do. That's the first thing. You have to be open to that. And then the second thing is finding the folks that want to work with you. They want you to be successful. And because they see, like Andy was talking about, they see the benefits of having the farmer and the rancher out on the land.
Yeah.
Not everybody sees that, right? Some people just want to regulate you.
Yes.
And some people want your resources. Mm-hmm. And so you have to find, if you can find the people, and they're all out there. It's just difficult to find them sometime. And if you can find those folks that want to sit down with you and say, okay, here's the problem. How can we work together to solve this problem? Mm-hmm. Then it's a win-win.
Yes,
you generally end up with really good solutions and you end up with sustainable ranchers. There are a lot of ranchers who don't, you know, have not been able to find those folks. And there are some ranchers who don't want to work with those folks, you know, so you
haven't even try.
Yeah. So you have it on both sides and everybody's entitled to their own, you know, their own strategy in life, I guess. But I think if you can develop those relationships and those partnerships like Andy's been able to do, then you can really benefit both, you know, the resources and then the next generation, you know, going into, you know, whatever it is that Johnny and Hannah want to decide that they're going to do at the ranch. That's the other thing, is that we've never, we try to make decisions that give our kids options.
Yeah.
We don't ever try to make decisions that limit their options. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we've had a lot of folks come to us and say, you know, in terms of when you're asking about, you know, wanting to help ranchers stay in business and things like that, we've had a lot of folks come to us over the years, either just wanting to buy the place outright, or they would like, you know, we've had multiple agencies and nonprofits come and want to put the ranch in a perpetual easement, a conservation easement. And like I said, you know, everybody's entitled to what they think is best for their place. Mm-hmm. You know, that's their business. But for us, we feel pretty strongly about the fact that we've turned all of those down. Mm-hmm. And it's not easy to turn them down.
Absolutely.
Because in the ranching business, you are land rich and cash poor all the time. And so somebody comes and dangles, you know, tells you, hey, you know, you could put all your stresses away tomorrow for all the, you know, the cash stress that you have. And again, I think it's all out of positive motivation. And people that do that, that's in their interest. And they may have different motivations. They may not have a next generation that wants to take over the, you know, we're pretty fortunate in the fact that you can go, everything out here is old. And you can go anywhere here on the ranch and you can see Andy's ancestors and the work that they've done. You can see all the way up to the work that Andy's done. I can go out and I can see stuff that my son has already done. And so, you know, to think, okay, someday this might all be gone because two generations from now or one generation from now, you know, the ranch might be sold. You know, that's a possibility. But right now, that's not, you know, we are going to do the hard work and go through the stress to try to manage and balance the cash flow, but also the options, right? Which
means you're just trying to keep it to the best of its ability until the next generation.
Exactly.
And then the next generation, you just hand it over and they get to make the hard decisions that you guys had to make.
Exactly. You know, it's like, the decisions are hard, but we feel like every generation should have the ability to make that decision.
Yes, for sure.
And so we have not put our place in a conservation easement, and we're probably getting to be in the minority, I think, actually. But it limits it. Number one, it limits your options after that.
Yeah.
Because really the value in a ranch is not in the ranch. Right. It's in the development value. Mm-hmm. Right. And so if you want to go get a loan, and you're in a perpetual conservation easement, that limits your options, right?
Right.
To get bank financing. But it also changes kind of the dynamic of the management of the ranch, right? Yeah. Because if we went to Johnny or Hannah and said, oh, well, we just put the ranch in this, you know, perpetual conservation easement, it can never be developed, you know, it, you know, we've all these things cannot happen and these things can happen, then we sort of feel like it.
You tied their hands up.
Well, yeah, we've tied their hands, and we've created a situation where they don't have to make some of the tough decisions,
right?
It's like, how does that change the decision of, like Andy mentioned before, he kind of glossed over it, but when his dad passed away and we were in that drought year, we liquidated 75% of the herd.
Yeah.
And the reason that we did that, we knew we were going to have issues with cash flow. But at the same time, the reason we did that was because we didn't want to overgraze the grass that we had.
Yeah.
And so we had to make the tough decisions to get rid of those cattle.
And know that you're going to have to.
And know that we're going to spend, it wasn't until 2 years ago, I think, that
probably
we got the
double,
numbers
yeah,
back
double
up.
What you,
yeah, it
you
takes
for, lost on.
It takes forever in a ranch. People always say that, well, why not just sell the cattle and save your money and then buy them back?
That don't work like
only
that.
Only it was that easy.
It don't work that way.
Yeah, and so it took years. It took a decade. It took more than one decade to get us back where we were supposed to be. And so, you know, I don't necessarily, you know, think that's great that, you know, it's kind of like, okay, Hannah and Johnny, you're going to have to make some tough decisions like that too. But we want them to make right decisions based on the outcomes, not just, yeah. Well, we don't have to make the right decisions because, you know, we've got this kind of this cushion here, right? Mm-hmm. We didn't have a cushion and we had to make a tough decision, but we're so glad that we did. I don't know if all of that makes sense, but
yeah,
it's absolutely. I just think it's a big part of ranching and trying to figure out kind of what your future is and working with agents.
Andy kind of said something really good last night. He's like, being a rancher, you got to be a lawyer and a judge and a decision maker. And I mean, you got to be in the whole package to be a rancher, really.
Yeah, I mean, because most of the time you're in situations where you can't afford to have people come out and do things for you. Mm-mm. You know, you have to kind of figure it out yourself, and you know, you have to be all of these tradesmen, you know, at once.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if I had known I was going to marry Andy, I may have gotten a different degree, even though my degree applies out here. I mean, I'm not out here doing studies or anything, right? I'm more working in policy now. I'm more working in natural resource policy. So my degree helps me because I speak the language. I can understand what's going on. But at the same time, you know, maybe I should have gotten a degree in political science or in, you know, law or accounting or, you know, how to fix up old houses. Or. But anyway, so yeah.
Is here like super old?
Yes.
Like some 102-year-old guy that used to work.
Yeah.
Here. Yeah.
Has he made it? Did he make it?
So as you guys probably saw, my dad come walking through and actually came into the shot while they were talking. But we had a pretty cool little experience where, what was his name?
Bill Strong.
Bill Strong. He's 103 years old. U.S. He's a
in the air. He's got
103. Okay. So
he was
yeah.
in the Air Force.
Yeah.
134th Infantry, is that what he said?
I think so.
I think 134th Infantry.
But yeah. But he used to go to school here, right? The schoolhouse.
When he was 7 years old.
7 years old, yeah. So.
And actually, where we've got the table set up, there's a window, and I don't think you guys can see it, but right inside that window is what used to be a one-room house, and that was where the teachers lived when they worked on the ranch here or whatever, or taught on the ranch.
Yeah.
And that's where his mom was the teacher, and when he was like 7 years old, that's where they lived.
And that's crazy. He still remembers all that.
Yeah, it is.
That's wild. So, Andy, real quick, will you kind of explain all those brands that are on that shelf in there and the Carlink, your brand, and just that some of those guns and some of that the survey link or the yeah.
Survey chain.
The survey chain, yeah.
Yeah, so that's some of the history there. The brand, our brand, the Carlink actually came, the idea came from the old train carts, the old chain, big chain links. And I don't know exactly why they chose that, but that was the idea. That's where they got the idea from, the old Carlinks, which is lucky for me because it's easy to build. It's basically a squashed O, like a chain link, and we put it on the left hip of our cattle. But at one time, we owned like 100 different brands when they bought out all the different homesteads. When they settled here and put the ranch together, they put it together by my great uncle. He learned how to survey, and the original surveying chain's still in there. And he would go survey and find where the best waters were. And then there was a mercantile in Tucson, the Steinfeld mercantile, that he knew the Steinfeld family, and they had all these deeds that people would borrow to buy goods and supplies to bring back out here, and then they would get so far in debt that they couldn't pay their bill. So they would basically sell my grandfather he'd figure out where the water, good waters and so forth are, and he'd buy the deeds from them, and so that's how we came up. That's how we acquired most of the land that we have is by and when you bought the homestead, most of those people had their own brand, and so with the land you got the brand, which we didn't.
Since they had their cattle was already branded with that, so you guys kind of, when you bought the house and the land and their cows that was on it, you got the brand that way. You owned the cows too.
Yeah, and I always wondered, well, how the heck did he go kick these people out of their houses, or you know, and tell them I just bought your land.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact was, is it was really hard to make it on 160 acres or even 640 acres with just having that. It's not enough grazing land out here in this country to make it a living. And so what he would do is usually there were good cowboys or knew how to farm or ranch, and so he would hire them on and let them live there for the rest of their life. And then, you know, when they passed on or quit or whatever, then he would get the
take
land.
It over.
He would take over the land, and that's how he dealt with taking, you know, buying up all this property and so forth.
Yeah,
and some people just wanted to. Some of them just wanted. He didn't buy them all like that. Some of them just wanted to sell out because they realized that they couldn't make it, and they wanted to move on and do something else because it just wasn't enough land to make it on.
Right. Yeah, and so earlier you were kind of also explaining, you know, there with all the property now. As a rancher, people can come in and kind of, you know, flash a pretty big price tag in front of your face. What keeps you wanting to keep ranching? Like, I know last night we kind of had a conversation how previous generations, it probably was more about money, but now it's more about the lifestyle and actually...
the heritage. And
Yeah.
Well, it's become a lifestyle for me growing up out here, and I realize I see, you know, I see a lot of my generation and other generations may, you know, sell off and see what their life's like now, you know, and you know, the old saying, money doesn't buy happiness. I think there's a lot of truth to that. And I just know that if we ever sell the land, usually when you sell a ranch like this, you're not going to get it back. You're not going to buy it back for less than you sold it for. Right. And not only that, I actually have never really, I don't even consider selling it or an easement. Because it's like, you know, I just had the chance as fifth generation to come and I've been, you know, a lot of this land I was lucky enough to inherit it, which people work their whole lives to do, and mm-hmm. I appreciate what I have. And I don't, you know, I don't feel like it's even a right of mine to sell land. And so therefore, I mean, I've actually bought back or leased or bought back two of the ranches that my grandfather sold off, which he looked at a little differently than my dad and myself, and sort of put it back together. Because I am so interested in the heritage and you know, like any business, you've got to keep growing and innovating and you have to, you know, growth is usually creates more sustainability if you grow right and smart. And so, you have to keep growing in one way or the other, or innovating in one way or the other, and diversifying. You know, that's what's kept us going, is the diversification of this ranch. But I've never looked at, like, I same as I don't want to put in an easement, I don't think it's right to tie up, which my wife explained, you know, it, you know, you don't appreciate it as much if you know.
You don't have to make them hard decisions. Yeah. You know, you're not going to appreciate the land and what it's been through for five generations, 139 years. You know, you're not going to appreciate that as much if you ain't going to make them little decisions on not letting somebody have an easement through.
Yeah, and you want the next generation to have value in it. It's crazy. We fight all these, you know, issues. The majority of when we Steph got into the fight was fighting to keep our development rights. We're sitting mm-hmm. there with developers. We have less houses than we had 100 years ago on this land. You know, I'm not for development at all, yeah. but I am for keeping our value. And it's not mm-hmm. fair that just because every other ranch subdivided and built houses, that we should lose our rights to do that. Because right. my dad always said, if they're going to take away all your rights mm-hmm. of farming, ranching, and what you want, and you're doing a good job with the natural resources, then subdivide. Then get every mm-hmm. penny you can out of that land. If you are going to go out of business,
yeah,
make sure you get every penny, because there's been five generations that worked pretty hard to keep
Absolutely.
It there.
Absolutely, yeah.
And I tell my kids the same thing. It's just like giving someone a house or something and saying, you know, I want you to maintain this house, keep it, you know, preserved and everything else. But you can never sell it. But you're requiring that they keep it in good shape, but you can't get a loan on it because it's worth nothing now. It's just, but it's yours. You can have the house, but you want, you know, a lot of people aren't going to keep it pristine because, or a car or anything else. You could look at any scale you want. And it's the same way with a ranch, you know. You know, we could give them a pile of money and say, you know, here's this money. We got you some money so you can live easier than we did, but you can never sell the ranch. But, you know, you need to go out and manage that land and move them cattle. Mm-hmm. So you have a pile of money sitting there. You think you're going to get up in the morning and go move them cattle?
Mm-mm.
No, you're not going to be as good a manager. Right. Like I said, starvation creates innovation. You know,
we need a t-shirt made.
Yeah. We're gonna trademark that.
Yeah,
we'll put Carlink Ranch. Starvation yeah. creates yeah. innovation.
A little credit.
Yeah, I guess the last thing to kind of touch on. I'm sure we could sit here and talk for hours, but you know, today Yellowstone is a huge show, and it shows the different struggles and different things that they have to overcome to keep the ranch going. So, with all the things that you feel like you have to, you know, constantly defend your ranch against, you know, whether it be water rights or whatever other, you know, things that come in the way
land
of that.
Developers.
Yeah. What's, I guess, how accurate is that show, would you say? Because I know we talked about it a little bit last night, but and maybe Steph, you've seen it more than Andy, but what's your thoughts on
well,
that?
Well, I've heard a lot about it. Everyone yeah. watches. I've watched right. a couple episodes, but and all I wish is there was a train station here. We could still do that. But no. Actually, you know, the big picture, there's a lot of parallels, believe it or not. I mean, some of the stuff like how they vaccinate cattle, and you see it, you know, I look at details because I'm in the business, exactly. right? So I find stuff where other people wouldn't find stuff. But the general...
yeah,
the
yeah.
general theme of the movie and stuff is you know, is good. I think it leaves a good impression. I mean, it's not bad. It's good for ranching, I think, and it's similar. It's real similar to us. You know, we're not totally unique from any other ranch, but we're probably in a more difficult place to ranch because of the environmental issues. We're sort of under a spotlight in Arizona because we're along the San Pedro River Valley, which they've highlighted as big migratory bird habitat and so forth. And it's sort of put us on the map to say, and that's why we've had to be, they've tried to restrict us more than a lot of ranches and farms. And so there is a lot of parallel. I mean, you have to be diverse. My dad always told me that, I mean, the key to keeping this ranch, one of the keys to keep that we've been able to keep this ranch going is because my dad was very forward thinking, and whether it be how we brand the cattle or how we do things and we do different things than a lot of people, but mainly he told me, Andy, if you're going to run that ranch, you've got to get involved with politics, and you've got to know how to public speak, and you have to get to know a lot of people. So in college, I mean, everyone thought I was going to become a politician because I was, you know, president of the ag council and stuff, and I was real involved, which Stephanie really wasn't until she got married to me, and thank goodness she is, because she's way better at it than I am.
She's more involved than you are now.
Yeah, and everyone says, man, your wife, you know, how long have you done it? But anyway, and everyone says she's the smart one, but I think I'm the smart one because I get to stay on the ranch and farm, and she's in meetings all the time. And but she, yeah, but that's the key. I mean, it doesn't matter how hard you work and what kind of cattle you have and how good you do in your business, if they turn you into a monument, which they've tried here, mm-hmm. or a park, or if they tell you you can't farm and you can't use this water, and you know, all of a sudden you're done.
All that work. Four generations before you, it's over.
It's over. It doesn't matter. So, like, I mean, if, you know, what's the most important thing on this ranch is, I always say, is what Stephanie does, because, you know, it's going to meeting, it's fighting the politics, and it's, I mean, and it's worth it. I mean, you know, there's not too many people that can, you know, say that they're doing what we're doing, but it's not easier. It's like saying, my wife, you know, everyone comes out here and we got this big ranch, nice house and everything, and they say, you're so dang lucky, you know. And my wife told me one day, she said, next time someone tells me that, I'm going to tell them, yeah, the harder I work, the luckier I get. Because, you know, it's a lot of hard work.
Yeah,
and it's not easy. But when you're doing something you love, like myself, I mean, I don't look at it as really hard work. I look at it because I enjoy it. I wouldn't do anything else, you know, and it's what I love doing. So yeah. With that, I'll let Steph.
Well, I think you pretty much said it in terms of the... More than we need. In terms of, but your question about the show, you know, when I first started watching it, I thought Andy's going to hate this show because, you know, there's a lot of drama and whatever. But you know, it really took off, and people just love it. And gosh, I mean, I see Yellowstone stuff everywhere. Mm-hmm. In fact, I was in Texas last week, and I met one of the police officers, whatever, that does some of the security for the creator. And he asked me the same question. He said, what do you think? Before I knew who he was, he said, what do you think of that show Yellowstone? So I told him, I said, you know what? I said, after I've watched it, you know, quite a bit, I said, I really appreciate it because I think that that show has brought more attention to the ranching lifestyle and the fact that it's not just sitting on your porch drinking iced tea watching the sun go down.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
There's a lot of work and there's a lot of, you know, like Andy said, being in politics and the environmental. And I think that what the show has done is it's been able to make it interesting. That's why people like it, right? If it was a documentary about just a rancher's life, people probably
wouldn't have as much attention.
Yeah, but what it does is it takes real issues that we deal with, and it might dramatize them a little bit, but it lets people know that this is what life's really like, in the sense that you're constantly dealing with encroachment. You're constantly dealing with pressures, you know, to do something different with the ranch and different things like that. So I told this gentleman, though, I said, well, I said, but if you have a chance to talk to Mr. Sheridan, I said, I would appreciate it if you told him if there was less nudity and less F-bombs so I could watch it with my son. but it is, I appreciate the fact that it brings some real life issues into what we do. And so people can really think, oh, gosh, you know, that is a big deal that ranchers have to deal with predators and they can't really do anything about it, like with the wolf. So,
yeah, you know, it's interesting, I think, too, like not coming from a ranching background or anything like that. You know, I'd watch a show and I'd be like, oh, man, that must be what it's really like. But or just in general, I guess in my mind, I would be like, I think of a ranch and I just think of, like, you know, just working cows all day and not necessarily being involved in politics and understanding what it might take to fight to have water to feed your cattle or your, you know, to grow crops or whatever it might be. So it's interesting the different perspectives that, you know, people are able to see on the show. And some people might just think it's, you know, dramatized, but I really do think, in a sense, you know, after hearing your story, how much you have to go through in order to get to a legal level or, you know, just all the stuff that you do and involve yourself in to benefit not only your ranch, but all the farmers and future ranchers. So I think that's really awesome. So, but anyways, we, like I said, we could talk for another 3 hours on it, but we appreciate you having us out to the ranch.
Yeah. Thank you guys very much. It's been an amazing opportunity.
Well, thank you guys for being here and being interested in the story.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's good that you guys are educating the public on what you're doing, whether it's rodeo or ranching or whatever, you know, the rural lifestyle and what you guys are doing. It's a good deal.
Yeah.
We need to do more of it.
Yeah, sure. We appreciate it. Well, the way that we end our show is we ask our guests what the first song that comes to their mind is, and then we all sing together to end the show. So what's the first song that comes to your mind?
You know what's going to come to my mind.
Oh, no.
Luke Combs. What's it called? No, I just went blank.
Start singing
not
it.
Not everything goes on forever.
Oh, you know.
Nothing lasts forever.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. What's that song?
That's a tough exit question.
And we catch them all off guard.
You should know it. Don't you? Don't you? Here, let's just pick up a text I send you.
He sends it to me.
When it comes on, I send it to Steph.
Yeah. Okay, I've got it.
Not everything lasts forever, I think it's called.
So all right. you guys got to sing, though.
You're going to have to put that mic in the middle.
Yeah.
Neither one of us.
It's all right. We can't either.
We always.
It just makes it fun.
Yeah. You should be able to sing it by now.
Oh, so bad at this.
Do you need the lyrics? I got the lyrics right here if you need them. Here, let me.
A cold beer's got 12 ounces. A good truck's got maybe 300,000. You only get so much until it's gone. Duracell's in a mag light. A needle drop on a 45. All the kind of things that only last so long. When the new wears off and they get to getting old. Sooner or later, time's gonna take its toll. They say nothing lasts forever, but they ain't seen us together or the way the moonlight dances in your eyes. Just a t-shirt in the kitchen with no makeup and a million other things that I could look at my A love like that makes a man have second thoughts. Maybe some things last forever after all.
Well, thank y'all for checking in, sticking around,
and listening to another episode of the Everything Rodeo Podcast. Thank you very much, Stephanie and Andy, for joining us today. It's been a real pleasure.
So let me ask one more question. Why was that so emotional for you?
Because of what it says, it's hard to make things last forever, but we're doing it.
And that applies to the ranch and your marriage and everything.
Yeah.
And I thought it was kind of cool where it talks about moonlight, because the young man that was just here that's 102 years old, we asked him what was the main thing in your life that you remembered that was just the most amazing thing. And he said that he was riding the ship. And he was in between Italy and
he was riding the ship from England to Africa.
Africa.
And he was going through the Strait of Gibraltar.
That's right.
Yeah. And he said that the moonlight was
so bright,
was reflecting off of the wake of the boat. And he said that it was the most pretty thing
that
he had
ever seen. When the wakes would hit the boat and spray the water, it lit up between the two islands too. Mm-hmm. Is just one of the things that he'd remembered most. So,
but he said that was the prettiest thing he'd ever seen.
Yeah.
And you know, that's kind of cool that a guy that's been through so much, he's been through, you know, world wars and seen the car evolve and cell phones and everything, and the thing that he remembers most is not what happened in the war or, you know, somebody driving a car instead of riding a horse, but just the beautiful creation that God created.
Yeah. So thank you for your efforts and all that you guys do for us as consumers, and just we I don't know, we pray for continued success with the ranch.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
You guys are awesome. Rotten.
Why is that? You're the one who made the tears fall.
I should say you're rotten.
Is that like your guys' song?